moved to a city many miles away. But the woman had never forgotten her kindness. She didn't have any money to buy a present. There wasn't enough time to weave some cloth or make a basket out of grass. How would she be able to give her teacher a gift, a remembrance of the time that they had spent together? The woman reached and picked up a small worn bowl and wrapped her headscarf around it. Then she set out in the city. She walked for several days, stopping only to eat and to sleep. Finally, she reached the teacher's doorstep. She rang the doorbell and waited. But the door was opened by a stranger who told her that she was too late. The teacher had already left. The woman said nothing. She simply nodded her head and turned back toward the village and toward her home. When she got there, the women of the village gathered around. "It's too bad," they told her, "that you arrived too late to give her your gift." The woman raised her tired head and said quietly, "You don't understand. The gift was the walk." Part of the appeal of this story for me is that it takes place in a faraway country where walking is a gift. But even in the United States, you and I know more than we might first expect about how walks and gifts go together. Just think about it. On any given weekend, you can find a marathon or a walk organized on behalf of some worthy cause. We even invent catchy names for these events. The March of Dimes, the Race for the Cure. So it seems that the partnership between physical motion and gift is deeply imprinted in our DNA. So even if we don't think about it consciously, we sense that any walk we take is always more than a walk. It is also our gift. So, welcome to Epiphany. Here we are in this wonderful in-between season of the church year. And if there's one single theme that weaves its way through the Gospels during Epiphany, it is this curious coming together of walk and gifts. We were all the wise men bringing their gifts to the Christ child. Weren't those gifts more precious because of the hundreds of miles that the Magi had traveled? And what about the calling of the disciples that we'll hear about in next week's gospel? Jesus will say, "Come and follow. Start walking." And so one by one, Andrew and Simon Peter and all the others will leave what they're doing and begin a life-changing journey. Each walk given shapes a life. Each new walk becomes a gift. Because following the incarnate Son of God is not a casual stroll. It is an intentional journey. So, where do we begin? Let's start our walk this morning by imagining Jesus as we see him in Mark's Gospel. Jesus is resting on the riverbank after reaching the muddy waters. It's quite likely that he has walked there, though none of the gospel writers fills in that particular detail. When we see him, he has paused for a minute at the edge of the Jordan River. In my mind's eye, I can imagine Jesus standing very still, as if he is feeling the marvelous embrace of God. Even though surrounded by a crowd, he seems to be alone. His eyes are open, though unfocused. His body is relaxed. And then he moves forward, one foot in front of the other. Lapping over his toes, water at his ankles, and then at his knees. He is walking slowly and deliberately toward John the Baptizer. He is taking our place in the water. He is standing beside us in our full humanity, because he has come to be our Emmanuel, the God who walks with us. Through his motion, we glimpse the God who walked with Abraham and Sarah, the God who walked with Moses through the wilderness, the God who walked with the Israelites into exile, and the God who brought them home. This God, incarnate in his beloved Son, is revealed fully to us this morning as both gift and walk. Some of us were raised to think of baptism simply as a one-time gift that we receive. But our baptism is so much more than that. Our baptism, yours and mine, was the beginning of a journey where the only way to grow is to walk. If we understand this about baptism, we won't get upset when Jesus calls us to expand our comfort zone. We won't be dismayed when we think our feet are going to places where we are asked to confront the imperfect justice of this world. Where might you walk with Jesus this year? Would you go so far as to your city council meeting to ask that minimum wage be walked closer to living wage? Would you go to your senator's local office and argue for the restoration of the CHIPS program so that 80,000 children in Alabama can get basic health care? If you do go, you'll find many companions of Christ on the road with you, because Jesus has taught us to oppose actions that deny our neighbors the privileges we take for granted. Would you go as far as to Montgomery to speak out against predatory lending practices, ones that reinforce the noose of poverty in this state? If you do, you will find the companions of Jesus there, because he himself was clear about where he stood on the greed of money changers. Would you go to Hayville, Alabama, in the middle of August and walk with others as part of Jonathan Daniels' pilgrimage? If you do, you'll be joining others who walk to mend the lingering vestiges of racism. Would you go to prison? You will find Jesus there, because he too was a prisoner. Would you go to death row? Even there you will find him, because he also was condemned to die. It's all the same as the wise African woman whose story I told at the beginning of the homily knew so well. The most important gift that we Christians have is our walk. Each of us brings along with us diverse skills and talents, diverse hopes and dreams. But it's only when we give ourselves that we truly understand God's gift to us. We who have walked through the waters of baptism with Christ have been raised to new life through the power of the Spirit. Our lifelong journey has already begun. But be of good cheer. Everywhere we walk, we will find that God is already present. There's no place we can escape from his love. This is what Jesus knew as he himself waded into the water on our behalf. So my prayer this morning is simply this. As we set out together in the season of Epiphany, let us honor our walk and honor our gifts. Because in Christ,